To another episode of Leaving the Farm right here on Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, where information never sleeps. We are a listener-supported radio station. What if you'd like to donate, please visit us at www.freedomslips.com and click on our support pages. Every little bit helps. I was checking the numbers last night by going to Freedom Slips chat. Looks like we're down quite a bit for the month. If you want to pitch in, we always get nervous when we see the numbers and we realize we might not be here next month. And it's quite a profound thing, and we do thank everybody for keeping us on the air, keeping us here, and of course supporting all of us. TammyPepperman.org is also only listener supported. We are not corporately funded. We are not funded to bring you any lies, and tonight's show is just, I've got a lineup that's absolutely crazy. If you'd like to donate to keep TammyPepperman.org online, on the internet, please visit our site at TammyPepperman.org and click on our donate button. And this, what it does is donates to TamworthWebDevelopment.co.uk. Same folks that are keeping us here. And, of course, No Borders Radio in the UK is only listener-supported. We're not part of the Broadcasting Board of Governors. We're not part of ABC. We're not part of NBC. We're not part of any of these entities that are facilitating this massive fraud in the UK, Russia, Moscow. I mean, all of these things that the mainstream media is bringing to you, to your table, to your television, to your children. This is just foul. Before I get into the show, next week Clint Richardson will be here on Leaving the Farm, Saturday night, 6 to 8 p.m. right here on Revolution Radio and No Borders, as well as Tyrannosaur, and over on SSOTL, of course. Let's see, I wanted to get into the breaking news out of Texas, Dibble, Texas. The roof of a privately run jail has collapsed, temporarily trapping dozens of inmates and sending 10 of them to nearby hospitals. This is being reported out of clicktohouston.com. Excuse me. The incident happened Saturday morning at the Dibble Correction Center in Dibble, about 10 miles south of Lufkin and 105 miles northeast of Houston. We're told about 40 people have been hurt, but there are no serious injuries. Injured, brought into law, are being sent to hospitals by medical hospital, helicopter, and ambulance, and an unspecified number of inmates are being treated at the scene. Interestingly enough, last year the United States sued, the United States Incorporated, including the International Corrections and Prisons Association, and I'll be darned if this isn't one of them. The 518-bed minimum security prison. Minimum security is operated by Centerville, Utah-based Management Training Corporation. Let me say that again. Utah-based Management and Training Corporation. Now, of course, all of these things are with USAID, the development of the UN. The United Nations are cashing in on the demise of everybody, bringing everybody into law. And who's the parent corporation of the United Nations? None other than Congress. From SWTimes.com, Sebastian County inmate dies. An inmate at Sebastian County Adult Detention Center died early Saturday after she was found unresponsive. Amanda Potter, 39, was found unresponsive in a holding cell about 4 a.m. Saturday, according to a news release from Lieutenant Philip Pevahaus with the Sebastian County Sheriff's Office. Detention Center personnel performed life-saving procedures, the release states, and Potter was transported to Sparks Hospital emergency room after EMS responded. She was pronounced dead at 4:45 a.m. with an initial ruling of cardiorespiratory arrest. Okay, now all of you that just felt comfort in a diagnosis, cardio, heart, respiratory, lungs, arrest, stopping. That is not a diagnosis. It's not an explanation of why her heart and lungs stopped. If you continue to accept these things, tolerate these things, and you don't look into why a 39-year-old female just died in a prison setting, these are all private prisons. These are all revenue generation schemes. And these are all part of the banking industry. This is Nazi Germany. The Federal Republic of Germany is a corporation located in the District of Columbia. That is Washington, D.C., for all of you who don't put that together. That is Congress. That is the Senate and House of Representatives, the same folks that you patronize, perpetrating every known Holocaust since the inception of time. They used to be called Rome. They've been called many, many things. Every time they're about to get caught out, they change their names. Rome, Roman Empire, Club of Rome, education itself. It used to be called the Academia de Lince, meaning the Academy of the Lynx-Eyed, that gravitated into the Club of Rome. You all want to blame the Club of Rome. Oh, it's just a little group of people. It's not just a group of people. It's always been Rome, Germany, Ukraine, Australia, Russia, Canada, the UK, France, Greece, Asia, China. All of these prison deaths, all of these deaths. Congress in 1924 came in with the Racial Integrity Act. March 20th, 1924, the Virginia General Assembly passed two laws that had arisen out of contemporary concerns about eugenics and race. Now, as you all just separated in your mind, black, white, red, yellow, stop that thought in its tracks. The human race is not, absolutely not psychopathic. The psychopath is missing the frontal lobe. It is not the same race as the human race. The psychopath is a devolved species. It is not evolved to be human. This was listed as SB 219, entitled the Racial Integrity Act, and SB 281, an act to provide for the sexual sterilization of inmates of state institutions in certain cases. Community is an institution. Community is a social institution. And in 2010, the psychiatrist started coming in and treating male children with autism with Lupron, chemically castrating your children and facilitating the action set forth in the 1924 Racial Integrity Act in Florida. That was the model stomping grounds. Because you tolerate these things, it moves. It becomes the norm. If you do not tolerate these things, they go away. Stop patronizing Rome. You are acting as Roman citizens. You are being romantic. That's a socially engineered state. The act of being a Roman citizen. When you buy your loved one something to observe a value or to place or maintain a denomination, you are acting as a Roman citizen. patriotism. You are acting as a Spartan. This is Sparta. This is Rome. Stop patronizing Caesar. You're told, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's and unto God what is God's. What does Caesar get? You're not supposed to give it your patriotism, honor it, and call it your honor. Call it your father. You are supposed to be handing it back his butt. That's his. He doesn't have anything else. Outside of your buying into these concepts, Caesar owns nothing. And this is just sad. Dozens hurt in this roof collapse. Another female has been killed in a jail setting. You can find the text of the Racial Integrity Act even on Wiki. Just go look that up. Club of Rome on Wiki. Academia de Lincae, which is ACCADEMIA. DEILINCEI. You can find that also at Wiki. It's an interesting thing about Wiki today. Reports out of digitaltrends.com. Tweetbot catches Russia making edits to flight MH17 Wikipedia entry. Let's delve into that. So we need to go back a little bit into what this thing is, and we'll do that in a few moments. But as these things are being played out, and you're being maintained under such fallacy and media control, this is psychological warfare that you're experiencing. It is Stockholm Syndrome. You're patronizing it because you fear for your life or safety. You do it every day. You roll on each other. You inform on each other. Stop doing that. Jesus said, pick up your cross and follow me. That does not mean me. As in the psychological construct of the ego, the superego, or the id, which is your identification. He said, follow the one in front of you. Give up your life for the human being in front of you. That's what it's about. That's what it's all about. 1 Corinthians 13. Without faith, hope, and charity, which is light, love, there is actually nothing. There's nothing. There's a fiction. There's commerce and navigation. There's plastic wrap things, shiny things that you can purchase. What is that in actuality? Sure as heck isn't a human being. So in 1802, with the 1802 Indemnification Convention, they came in and established five commissions. Call missions with a mission, with an agenda. The five commissions are now known as the Federal Transparency Board. You can find that at recovery.gov. And of course, they scooped it into, I think there's seven or eight on there now. It starts at five and folds into each other. You'll notice that the Education Department and Energy fold into each other when they need it for the Economic Value, Department of Commerce. All of these things, and the Inspector Generals were created by the Inspector Generals Act of 1978. And at that point in time, human beings were better insured through the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, FDIC. The Fours of Sparta, go look that up. Those are the federal magistrates. You can find those at the Federal Magistrates Judges Association. Saving force. It's a game of risk taking over continents. Excuse me. With tenants. If you subscribe to living in the United States of America, you are a tenant. You're a resident, a thing, res. You've been taking over. The word for that is actually secession. You've been seceded or taken over upon your death. And that is in the law called civilly dead or civil death. You've abjured the realm, or you've been diagnosed as a felon, 18 U.S.C. 1342, because you're accepting mail using and assuming a fictional name or address. Well, what are you calling you? Doctor, blah, blah, blah. Well, blah, blah, blah in the first place. You're describing yourself. You know, the maiden name on the estate was Eric's son. I am not Eric's son. I'm God's son of the house of Eric, right? Or I'm God's son of the house of Peppermint. Or I'm God's son of the house of Smith. Jesus went into depth about that one when they tried to call him Jesus Davidson. He says, how is that possible? I can't call David Lord and God Lord at the same time. Who's your landlord? Who are you patronizing? Who are you worshiping? So we talked about the recovery.gov, Federal Transparency Board. Those are all the E4s out of Sparta. And you'll see how it moves around. You know, of course, you can go read the Protocols of Zion. It's the same game. Club of Rome. National Associations of the Club of Rome. That was very interesting because, of course, there's seven horns. And the Academia de Linci has 10 heads. General Council has approximately 666 members. For more information, you can go read the Treaty of Westphalia at avalon.law.yale.edu/17thcentury/Westphal, Westphal dot ASP. You also want to read another one when they moved into the Chinese territory, avalon.law.yale.edu/20th_century/TR22-01.ASP. Quote, desiring to adopt a policy designed to stabilize conditions in the Far East, to safeguard the rights and interests of China, and to promote intercourse between China and the other powers upon the basis of equality of opportunity. Congress is a bunch of opportunists. Give us your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to be free. If that's not a great opportunity, I don't know what is. Preying on the meek. Preying on the lower classes through fourth generation and asymmetrical warfare. Creating the classifications through the control of the inflation rates. The IMF, International Monetary Fund, controls the scarcity of all known currency. All of you in your mind, you just saw dollar bills flashing through your head. Commodities are currencies. Human resources are currencies. they're not just controlling the scarcity of debt notes or scarcity of lawful money or scarcity of oil or scarcity of corn or scarcity of wheat, pork, beef, chicken. They're controlling the scarcity of humankind. They've been saying that for years. Go back to the population bomb, Ulrich. Ulrich and Simon, they had a bet going on about how much influence it would take to cause you to react. Are you ever going to wake up? All of these things, and it's just so much to get through. What did the reporters for RT quit? Said I can't work for a liar. CNN then starts reporting the RT's a bunch of liars, and so is the Telegraph, and all of these things pointing fingers at each other. Let's get all this straight real quick. Italy is a corporation located in the District of Columbia. Italian Radio and Television Corporation located in the District of Columbia. Academic Travel Abroad, same thing, traded as Italy. International Brotherhood of Teamsters Union, 25 Louisiana Avenue, Northwest Washington, D.C., 20001, is traded and listed in Dun & Bradstreet as Rome. Get where we're going here? It's Congress. The Vatican. Located in Washington, D.C. Embassy of the Vatican City, 3339 Massachusetts Avenue, Northwest Washington, D.C., 20008. Patrons of the arts in the Vatican Museums, Washington, D.C., Balto Chapter. 2500 Virginia Avenue, Northwest, number 101, Washington, D.C., 20037. The Vatican is also traded as Vietnam America Trade and Investment Consulting Company, Incorporated. 1150 17th Street, Northwest, Suite 600, Washington, D.C., 20036. The Pope. Is listed as Millennium Products LP, 3003 17th Street Northeast, Washington DC 20018. Also listed as Pope Star, 110 15th Street Southeast, Washington DC 20003. Pope Charles E. Father, 4275 4th Street Southeast, Washington DC 20032. The Rome in Delaware is listed as Rome Pharmaceuticals Incorporated. 1019 White Birch Drive, Newark, Delaware, 19713. Rome and Associates, 24832 John J. Williams Highway, Unit 52, Millsboro, Delaware. Blank Rome, LLP, 1201 North Market Street, Suite 800, Wilmington, Delaware, 19801. Also listed at 1220 North Market Street, Floor 8, Wilmington, Delaware, 19801. Ukraine, Delaware. Ukraine Express, 201 Werthar Drive, Suite 2, Newark, Delaware, 19711. Ukraine Express Incorporated, 78 McCullough Drive, Newcastle, Delaware, 19720. Winner Group, Ukraine Incorporated, 911 North Tatnall Street, Wilmington, Delaware, 19801. Ukrainian National Association, 1507 Langham Road, Wilmington, Delaware, 19809. Russia, Delaware, Russian International Trade Corporation, 1013 Center Road, Wilmington, Delaware, 19805. SSIA Moda USA Incorporated, it is also known as Russia, 1209 North Orange Street, Wilmington, Delaware, 19801. U.S. Russia Investment Fund, comma, the 1209 North Orange Street, number STC, Wilmington, Delaware, 19801. Ukraine, Massachusetts, Ukraine Market Company, 56 Walsh Road, Newton, Massachusetts, 02459. Notable members of the Club of Rome list Vaclav Havel, one of the most profound quotes that ever came out of his mouth, this quote, quote, the post-totalitarian system touches people at every step, but it does so with its ideological gloves on. This is why life in the system is so thoroughly permeated with hypocrisy and lies. Government by bureaucracy is called popular government. The working class is enslaved in the name of the working class. The complete degradation of the individual is presented in his ultimate liberation. Depriving people of information is called making it available. The use of power to manipulate is called the public control of power. And the arbitrary abuse of power is called observing the legal code. The repression of culture is called its development. The expansion of imperial influence is presented as support for the oppressed. The lack of free expression becomes the highest form of freedom. Farcical elections become the highest form of democracy. Banning independent thought becomes the most scientific of worldviews. Military occupation becomes fraternal assistance because the regime is captive to its own lies. It must falsify everything. It falsifies the past, it falsifies the present, and it falsifies the future. It falsifies statistics. It pretends not to possess an omnipotent and unprincipled police apparatus. It pretends to respect human rights. It pretends to persecute no one. It pretends to fear nothing. It pretends to pretend nothing. And of course, we'll read about Vaclav Havel. He's a very interesting character there. Again, if you want to see part of the foundation, you want to go read the Convention for Indemnification of 1802 between Spain and the United States. That was what set up the original five commissions. Prisons, you name it, water rights. It's the action of human husbandry on a farm. The colony is a synonym for farm. Etymology means farm or landed estate. I wanted to go into the definition of, sorry about that, folks, to indemnify. A lot of you have the perverted version of indemnity. Indemnify, out of Black's Law Dictionary, first edition, 1891, to save harmless, to secure against loss or damage, to give surety for the reimbursement of a person in case of an anticipated loss falling upon him. You were indemnified to maintain life insurance for the corporations. That is called corporate welfare. That is in line with the first and second welfare theorem and Pareto optimality. You are expending all of your productive value, all of your assets, and redistributing them into the attorney's hands, as you're being farmed and sold rights, you're being sold ideologies, concepts, benefits. You know, that's an action of prostitution. And of course, you can find all of this documentation and evidence in one place at TammyPepperman.org. Here's another report from the New York Times. This morning it came out. I saw it this morning. Rikers, where mental illness meets brutality in jail. After being arrested on a misdemeanor charge following a family dispute last year, Jose Bautista was unable to post $250 bail and ended up in a jail on Rikers Island. A few days later, he tore his underwear, looped it around his neck, and tried to hang himself from the cell's highest bar. Four corrections officers rushed in and cut him down, but instead of notifying medical personnel, they handcuffed Mr. Bautista, forced him to lie face down on the cell floor, and began punching him with such force, according to New York City investigators, that he suffered a perforated bowel and needed emergency surgery. That's injury, folks. He was brought into law to the benefit of attorneys. Each and every diagnosis is putting money into their coffers. This is what the game of Polycratis is, or politics. It's a practice of law. Just a few weeks earlier, Andre Lane was locked in solitary confinement in a Rikers cell block reserved for inmates with mental illnesses when he became angry at the guards for not giving him his dinner and splashed them with either water or urine. Corrections officers handcuffed him to a gurney and transported him to a clinic examination room beyond the range of video cameras, where witnesses say several guards beat him as members of the medical staff begged for them to stop. The next morning, the walls and cabinets of the examination room were still stained with Mr. Lane's blood. The assaults on Mr. Bautista and Mr. Lane were not isolated episodes. Brutal attacks by correction officers on inmates, particularly those with mental health issues, are common occurrences inside Rikers, the country's second largest jail, a four-month investigation by the New York Times found. Okay, I don't have to investigate anything. The 1924 Racial Integrity Act and the 1947 National Security Act says that they're going to beat the hell out of all of us. National Security says that all humanity is the enemy of the state and all humanity has to be diagnosed in order to discharge congressional bankruptcy, which was repeated by the evidence by Scott K. Summers in my conversation with him as a corporate counsel attorney, conservator from McHenry County, Illinois, wherein he said in order to discharge congressional bankruptcy, he has to have a diagnosis. That means that your little girl has to be raped by one of its actors. Your little boy has to be found hanging in your garage on Father's Day like Thomas Erbs. Your little girl, a single mother with five children, is going to be gunned down on a highway in Cook County because Cook County conservators need to discharge congressional bankruptcy through the action of not only death derivatives, but taking those five children into the child sex trafficking industry. Your mother's going to be killed in the hospital today. Your uncle's going to die in a one-car accident in just a few moments. Your brother's going to be gunned down in the Ukraine or Israel on the all along the Gaza Strip, Palestine. Those are diagnoses. Congress is going to shoot down a plane full of you, 300 of you or so, to discharge congressional bankruptcy. And then they're going to put on a show with their clergy, Putin, to say, oh, it's somebody else. or their clergy Netanyahu to say it's something else, or their clergy Obama to say it's something else, or their prime minister to say it's something else. This is the same criminal organization known as a confederacy. Defined in Black's Law Dictionary, confederacy is defined as a criminal enterprise. The very last line of the Black's Law Dictionary, first edition, 1891, of the definition of confederacy is see federal government. Your aunt's gonna be beaten this week. 42 of your sisters, daughters, mothers, and grandmothers are gonna be murdered by the pharmaceutical industry today. 35,000 of your brothers, dads, uncles, sons are going to be a suicide statistic this year in the United States Incorporated alone. If you buy into it, you are going to be diagnosed with cancer to discharge congressional bankruptcy. If you buy into it, you are going to be diagnosed with AIDS to discharge congressional bankruptcy. AIDS is a program. AIDS is the use of a chemotherapeutic antibiotic known as trimethylsulfate. The majority of you have been prescribed this medication. It's otherwise known as Bactrim or Septra. It also comes in cream form that you rub on your skin, and it says that it kills you. It says it can blind you. But as a chemical weapon, it breaks down the immunity through chronic use in order for you to be diagnosed with HIV. Chronic long-term use of trimethylsulfate in infants presents as shaken baby syndrome because trimethylsulfate creates the environment in the lungs for yeast to grow in the lungs. When your baby tries to cough that up, you find that it exhibits signs of being strangled because it has petechiae around the eyes, nose, ears, neck, and mouth. Your family doctor knows this, but in order to discharge congressional bankruptcy, your child's going to be killed by the medical industry, and you are going to be fingered as the perpetrator. In any other business, that's called a 2-for-1 special. I also urge everybody to read the Gulag Archipelago about when this was happening in Russia. And again, go look at the use of feminism during Bolshevik Russia. Yesterday I was sickened by a story that had come out again, because that's the one thing that I've been dealing with the most is females buying into this system. And this is written way, way back in Genesis. And in Genesis was Eve. She was snuck up upon in the garden. And the snake offers her all sorts of stuff. And in those offerings, she's being sold concept after concept after concept. And she's buying all of those things from the tree of knowledge, and she's convincing Adam that he should buy them too. The report yesterday was women used to find it as a fad to limp because one of their presentations had limped, and it just became commonplace for her to limp. It was the same thing with the hysterical female. When they sent all of the males off to war and the female was not receiving human touch, her body goes into atrophy. Uterus goes into atrophy. Cervix goes into atrophy. And she feels these things and it becomes discomfortable. It's not comfortable, uncomfortable. And she's in or at dis-ease. It's not comfortable. She's not at ease. Therefore, she's in dis-ease. So when she feels this dis-ease, Eve runs off to that snake in the garden. And the snake in the garden says, well, oh, you need a hysterectomy. We got to rip those parts out. That snake in the garden doesn't tell her that she's been separated from Adam because that's what controls her environment, her habitat. She's not told that Adam's been sent off to war to create the situation. She's not told that Jesus never said a word about having sex with another human. And indeed, Jesus said that you can only fornicate by giving your body over to that snake in the garden, the Lord God. 1 Corinthians 6. Eve's not told by that Lord God that it creates everything and sells her all these concepts so that it can render her and rip her apart. Simply based upon her patriotism, buying into those concepts. And we evidenced this last year with Bo's mother, Sonia Marie. And I don't talk a lot about that, the in-between. I was trying so hard to reach her, so I was going out to these social functions with Sonia. And the whole time she was going through her cancer diagnosis and chemotherapy and then radiation, the elderly females around her, they would compete with each other. It was a fad to have cancer. I have a better doctor. I have a better diagnosis. I have a better disease than you. Mine is a longer word. I'm more special. And all of those Eves were in the action of being slaughtered. And I couldn't reach any of them because the doctors have, they wear these pretty coats and they have these huge, humongous buildings to worship. And they have all these strange words that sound important. And I've been trying to reach you since, right after Sonia Marie passed away in November, Edna was diagnosed with cancer, and within like 4 months she died. And the same thing we watched occur with Bonnie, Phil's sister. She was threatened with excommunication from the church. The county had been harassing her, terrorizing her. She ran right into the arms of a doctor without a pathology ever done. The doctor diagnosed her with cancer. No test. No pathology. A diagnosis, and he says, you're terminal. That was in February. She died in June. She just gave up. The last time that Phil was witnessing these things occur, I was talking to Phil, and I'm like, how's Bonnie? And he says, well, she said she's got a headache, a slight headache. And then she laid down, and she never got back up because she had convinced herself, buying into these concepts, that she was terminal. So she just killed herself. How many females are doing that every single day and taking up these chemicals, chemical warfare? Chemotherapy is chemical warfare. Radiation is chemical and biological warfare because it's killing, massively killing cells. This is your garden. You need to get the snake out of your garden. It's flooding the garden. These things, they're not going to go away because you're patronizing them. You're asking them to be in your garden. You're telling it, give me more. Do more to me. I want your chemical cocktails. I want to die peacefully and to your benefit. Peace means pact. It means agreement between two banks. Treaties. Those are pacts. And peace is killing human beings to the benefit of national security. And again, go read the National Security Act. You could read up on the IHRSA, the IHRSA Institute, over at IHRSA-institute.org. On the left side, top of the page, HIV/AIDS programming. It was interesting to see how many AIDS programmers died in the Malaysian Airlines crash recently. It's a program. And you can read all about social dynamics. Go study social behavior, psychology, organizational psychology. So the IHRSA Institute says that it's programming law enforcement. That's why the you and law enforcement are clashing. Quote, the IHRSA Institute is a nonprofit, full-service social interest consulting firm engaged in behavioral science research, program design, development, and evaluation, training and technical assistance, survey and market research, social marketing and media advocacy to public and private sector policy makers and managers at the local, regional, statewide, and national levels. Founded in 1975, IHRSA Institute has completed projects in a wide array of fields. Over the past 28 years, our hundreds of projects have involved us in research and support in HIV/AIDS prevention, behavior change and treatment, public health and mental health programming, public health and mental health programming, family planning, child abuse and neglect, crime and delinquency programming, research and support in the fields of law enforcement, adjudication, and corrections. They are a source of indoctrination. These are actors employed in the human husbandry project. This is disgusting. What more can I say? Each and every day, you know, I go through these things. We constantly talk about these things, what more can I say? Somebody said, you know, why do you say dash and dot and blah, blah, blah? Please just spoon feed me everything. And it's like the icing on the cake. You're here at the X marks the spot because you've been indoctrinated to go for the human ease. You've been taught not to be the authority because there's something easier out there. You can always run off to that snake in the garden, the judge, or the snake in the garden, the doctor, or the snake in the garden psychiatrist, and it'll feed you what you want to hear when you want to hear it. And then it'll dope you up so you don't have to feel any of the effects of it. And ironically, that's what Aldous Huxley said. And it's been an interesting journey. Another great read, 8 pages, is from American Psychology. And of course, it is called The Origins of the Psychological Experiment as a Social Institution. That is what you know as government. That is what you know as politics. That is what you know as life. Since the inception of Polycrates, the human being has been a part of a psychological experiment as a social institution. It's otherwise known as game theory. And Roman law, winner take all. So if you're going to act as Roman citizens, you're going to have a Roman government over you. If you're going to be the Roman government, you're going to have Roman citizens under you. There's only those two venues. Quote, the psychological experiment involves a set of institutionalized role patterns that have evolved historically. This evolution can be studied by analyzing published experimental reports. From the beginning, there were two models for the social structure of the psychological experiment, the Leipzig and the Paris model. The latter emerged in the context of work on experimental hypnosis and involved a rigid social differentiation between experimenter and subject. By contrast, the Leipzig model involved the interchangeability of experimenter and subject roles. American investigators adopted both these models but also introduced more impersonal and less intensive relations between experimenters and subjects. Some implications of the multi-model origins of experimental situations are discussed. Wherever else it may be, the psychological experiment is clearly a social institution that has flourished in certain societies. And that implies patterns of social regulations that closely circumscribe the relationships of those who participate in it. The investigative situations in which knowledge about human psychology is gathered are highly institutionalized and involve a generally accepted distribution of role expectations among the participants. A clearly understood status differential and an elaborate set of rules governing the permissible interactions among the role incumbents. The sizable literature devoted to various aspects of the social psychology of the psychological experiment, For example, Adair, 1973, Jung, 1982, Rosenthal and Rosnow, 1975, Silverman, 1977, has paid virtually no attention to the history of the social features of the psychological experiment. Apart from Schultz's 1970 recognition of the fact that there is a history to the use of human subjects in psychological research, there has been no systematic attempt to uncover this history. Because the rules of scientific experimentation prescribe the preparation of a formal account of the proceedings for publication, the literature in psychological journals contains much material that throws light on historically changing social practices. Of course, published experimental articles mainly contain information on the public and formal aspects of the experimental situation, but it is precisely these aspects that are of interest in tracing historical changes in institutionalized patterns. In pursuing this kind of analysis, the wisest course is to pay special attention to historical beginnings. It is in the early stages of the growth of a field that fundamental directions of development are laid down and that traditions are established that become implicit models for later generations. Historians and philosophers of science have long recognized this by paying an extraordinary amount of attention to those 17th century developments that mark the beginning of modern physical science, even though the scientific production of that period represents only a tiny fraction of what was accomplished later. In the case of experimental psychology, the last two decades in the 19th and first two decades of the 20th century occupy a similar position. The material that provides the basis for the present discussion is drawn from a first half of this period, a time when the practice of psychological experimentation was in the process of becoming institutionalized. It involves an analysis of the procedures reported in all empirical studies published in the major relevant journals for the period from 1879 to 1898. You will find that it was the first model of feminism during the French Revolution. This includes two German language journals, Philosophische Studien and Zeitschrift für Psychologie und Physiologie der Sinnenorgane, which looks like the philosophy of the student and the I forgot what Fuhr means. It's psychology and physiology of something. I'll find them later. Two French language journals, Revue Philosophique and Annee Physiologique, and four English language journals, Mind, Pedagogical Seminary, American Journal of Psychology, and Psychological Review. Incipient institutionalization. One striking feature that characterized the first half of this period is the absence of an agreed-upon uniform nomenclature for identifying the participants in a psychological experiment. Although in the case of Wundt and his first group of students, we are dealing with a research community that was quite sharply defined in terms of goals, methods, and knowledge of each other's work, there are clearly no strong conventions about the identification of experimentor and subject roles. There is. If you go to such as Mises Institute and other anthropological sites, social behavior research, it's all there. In their published reports, different members of the Leipzig group use different terms to refer to experimentors and subjects in their experimental studies. The terms experimentor and subject do occur in several of the experimental reports, but their usage is far from general, and they are also used interchangeably with other terms. Some of these other terms were to have a more extended life, but others hardly survived this early period. Not only are there several alternative labels for the experimental subject, but there is also no uniformity of usage within the research community. They're innocent. They're directed by the same E-force. They're researching, and what they're doing is they're diagnosing based on a set of education that they have. And I was victim of this. I used to love psychology. There's a sociologist. I used to love these things. But what is a diagnosis? We're diagnosing based on a historical aspect, which is basically the same thing as the use of case law and common law in the law. Well, what's the cause of the diagnosis? You know, the physics of a thing say that there's, for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. If you're only diagnosing the reactive behavior, you're never going to get to the bottom of anything. Let's see. Sorry about that. Research community. This becomes particularly striking when two investigators are concerned with the same type of experimentally established phenomena, but use different terms to refer to their experimental subjects. And of course, because life itself, the socially designed creation of life, is one long-running psychological experiment, you're going to use different words to describe it because you've been taught different words. That's part of the compartmentalization. You know, medicine is written in Latin, and law is written in another form of Latin with French construct. You go all the way back to, pharmaceuticals, pharmacology is written in Latin, French, and Dutch. You've got Germanic flavor in there thrown in for the hell of it since the FDA and the Fiji contracting with each other. You know, that is Babylonian theory. For an example, in an early investigation of the quote time sense, Kohler, 1883, referred to his subjects, as reactors, whereas Estelle, 1885, whose study followed directly from Kohler, switched to the term observers. So instead of being, you know, part of the subject group, you're simply witnesses to it. Although you're still part of it, you never left it. And that's something that, everybody who has a title needs to realize, because they've been specialized. That's part of the programming, is the use of entitlement, specialty, to maintain the farm. This lack of semantic uniformity is also reflected in the fact that some investigators use two or three terms interchangeably within the same experimental report to refer to their experimental subjects, e.g. Merkel in 1885. Echoes of the Leipzig pattern during this early period are to be found in scattered experimental psychological reports published in English. Thus, G. Stanley Hall variously referred to the experimenter as the operator or the attendant, and to the subject as the observer, percipient, or subject. Hall and Donaldson, 1885, Hall and Jastrow, 1886, Hall and Motara, 1887. One early report from the Johns Hopkins Laboratory used the awkward formulation, quote, the individual under experiment, Stevens of 1886. But not surprisingly, this did not catch on. Among these early experimenters, Cattell was relatively consistent in his use of the term subject, but even he used it interchangeably with observer, Cattell 1888, Cattell and Bryant 1889. At times, and in his pioneering article on mental tests, he introduced the unsuccessful term experimentee, Cattell 1890. The original terminological chaos soon yielded to a very limited number of accepted terms, as the practice of psychological experimentation established its own recognized models and institutionalized patterns. By the mid-1890s, half of the experimental reports in the American Journal of Psychology and Psychological Review used the term subject, and a quarter referred or preferred observer. Regent was a distant third, and all other terms have remained purely idiosyncratic. However, it is worth noting that the crystallization of routine practice did not involve the adoption of a single model of usage, but of a small number of alternative models. It took virtually another half century for one model to achieve overwhelming preponderance. As late as 1930, there were heated discussions about the rival claims of observer and subjects. Bentley 1929, Dashiell 1930. The establishment of alternative terminologies was only a sign of the multi-model development of early experimental practice that needs to be examined. Role structure of the Wattian experiment. In the social system of the contemporary mainstream experiment, the function of serving as a data source is confined to the subject role, and this function cannot be combined with theoretical conceptualization, task administration, or publishing. No such segregation existed in the early stages of psychological experimentation. Once students frequently alternated with one another as stimulus administrators and sources of data within the same experiment. The case of Cattell and Berger has been documented in some detail in Sokol of 1980. Another early instance is provided by Lawrence and Merkel, Lawrence of 1885. Moreover, the person under whose name the published account of the experiment appeared was not necessarily the one who had played the experimenter role. For instance, Minor, 1885, published an article on an experiment in which he had functioned solely as the subject, although two other persons had functioned as experimenters at various times. Nor was the role of functioning as a data source considered incompatible with the function of theoretical conceptualization. Wundt, who generally shouldered much of this latter function himself in Leipzig experiments, also featured quite regularly as a subject or data source in these experiments, especially in the early days of his laboratory, e.g. Dietz, 1885, Estelle, 1885, Friedrich, 1883, Kohler, 1883, Tischer, 1883, and Trout Schultz, 1883. The experimental reports, however, were published under the names of his students. It is perfectly clear that the role of data source or subject was considered to be of higher or more important status than the role of the experimenter. The role of experimental subject was quite compatible with Wundt's exalted status, but once his laboratory got underway, none of the experimental reports mention him as having actually functioned in the role of the experimenter. We might also note that the participants in these early psychological experiments were never strangers to one another. They interacted outside the lab as a professor and student, as fellow students, and often as friends. This says it all in the 1929 Geneva Convention. You are all prisoners of war. Since 1933, when the, quote, Congress went bankrupt. And it said they're going to use all of you as fodder for discharging congressional bankruptcy by holding the human being and holding corporations as negotiable instruments. Every time you register, every time you get a license, every time you get a doctoral. I mean, that was one of the most profound things, was to, you know, be a part of this mess and, you know, do these theses and seek title. That's part of the psychological experiment. The priests and psychiatrists are there to promote you into seeking title, to prompt you to seek title. Let's do another thesis. Let's get our names out there. Let's get listed. Let's fill up our CV with all of these garbage historical foundations that say we are, instead of just being at relativity or reality. Look what I can do. You know, it's Saturday Night Live. And, anyway, this was written in February 1985. I can't see what, let me see if I can go to the bottom of it and see if there's a, it's an article out of The American Psychologist. Doesn't say what volume it is. It was written by Kurt Danziger. If you want more information, K-U-R-T, Danziger, D-A-N-Z-I-G-E-R, York University, Toronto, Canada, The Origins of the Psychological Experiment as a Social Institution. And of course, you know, you must go read the Racial Integrity Act, the eugenics, book, Psychiatrists, The Men Behind Hitler. They require a diagnosis. Listen to the audio that was done with myself when I called corporate counsel. At his request, it was after he got served with the genocide order out of the United States court, and he was mad about being served by duly authorized process server, and never thought he'd get caught. Never, ever, ever in his wildest imagination thought he would get caught diagnosing people to discharge congressional bankruptcy. And it went back. We found in McHenry County well beyond what we thought they were doing. Morocco's wife, originally, they had lived in that area, Lake County, McHenry County, and Laura had taken out a mortgage. And as that mortgage was paid off, Laura was diagnosed with cancer. And McHenry County came in to put a seizure on that estate and ended up killing Laura, Rocco's wife. And immediately thereafter, an agent working on the behalf of the state, Carlene Deanne Larson, trying to do, got him while he was still on his knees. She came in and made a claim against that house that was paid off on the behest of corporate counsel, Scott K. Summers there. And they all used the legal process to railroad Rocco, Robert Richard, into various states of institutionalization, including all of his 7 children being taken off and put into the care of the state. That's Summer's function. Mary Kay Wagner, of course, is a purchaser of children. She's a judge out of Kenosha County, Wisconsin. All of the other agents, of course, were employed to facilitate these actions. Sick Adam, Rocco's oldest, was murdered immediately after he aged out of the system and he was no longer a resource for the state. No longer a child, he could no longer derive captive funds, couldn't get the matching funds for the local municipality. Psychiatrists came in and made sure that he killed himself through the prescription industry. Pharmaceuticals. While they were to the side hammering on, of course, Rocco. And this is the way that they always do these things. This is what happens to every human being. This is why Rocco volunteered. This is why we volunteer. Instead of denying that these things occur, or fighting these things that occur, we just throw ourselves right into the den of vipers. And we say, okay, let's show everybody. Let's show humanity what's going on here. Because that's what Jesus said in 1 Corinthians 13. Jesus told us to suffer and bear all things. And then when you get it, that's when perfection comes. So if you want to stop my suffering and Rocco's suffering and the suffering of Amanda Potter, age 39, that was just now killed in jail, you can stop patronizing that thing and hold it accountable for genocide. They were found guilty already of genocide. They were found guilty by their own admissions of human trafficking. As we walked you through last year, they were trafficking me. They were terrorizing me. They were working me over. They've been working me over since I was born. We've been able to evidence these things for you step by step by step. If you want to stop the suffering, it stops when you stop patronizing it. And that's what Jesus said. Call no man your father. Don't patronize it. Stay away from it. 1 Corinthians 6, it says, don't even go into their courts. Hold them accountable. Don't you know that you're the judge? Don't you, and he was referring to you, the listener, don't you know that you're the judge? If you're calling something else your father, you're asking it to be your judge. You're the judge. You walk as a human. You do no harm. You already uphold the public law. You're not acting in acts of commerce and private acts. You're not tricking out other human beings. You're not molesting your children. Corporate counsel is. They have to. They must have a diagnosis. They must slam into you while you're driving to church one day, T-bone you so that you can be injured and brought into law, as we saw in Illinois this year. That detective T-boned that female, rammed into her, injuring her. And then criminalized her and said it was her fault. Because corporate counsel requires a diagnosis. On one hand, she was diagnosed as injury because she was harmed. And on the second one, she was used through the criminal industry to discharge congressional bankruptcy because she was fined. That would be like somebody assaulting me and telling me that I ran into their fist. Or that plane that was just brought down by Congress maintaining that the plane ran into a missile that had first priority in the sky. Which is what they're doing. They're discharging congressional bankruptcy. In the 14th Amendment, Lincoln, he was an attorney. Lincoln was clergy for Congress. Lincoln was a credit reporter for Dun & Bradstreet. Came in with the 14th Amendment and insured the corporations. That's life insurance. And you, human being, have been used to maintain corporate welfare since. Every time Donald Trump goes bankrupt, you are backing the bankrupt state. He goes on to build another company. You have that strapped around your neck as debt under the debenture participation program. To pay back Donald Trump's bankruptcy, you are going to be charged with a crime today. Your mother is going to be killed. Your daughter is going to be raped. Your son's going to be a suicide statistic. You're going to be traumatized to the extent that you will not be able to rise up off of your knees. Because you do not have the mark on your door, meaning education. Now, if you go to TammyPepperman.org, I provide you all of these things for free. All of these things for free. This is the mark on your door that says, leave me the hell alone. I know what you are. I know what you do. I can now see you coming. I do not patronize you. I do not require your representation. Get out of my garden. Get off my property. Get away from my kids. Get away from my community. Stop preying on human beings. That's the mark on the door. It's only education. If you go read Protagoras by Plato, it's all it is. Hippocrates, he wasn't the father of medicine. He wasn't the father of anything. He bought his license just like any other, quote, student. He didn't have any relative experience. He had a really smooth tongue and the willingness to part with his money. So, isn't that what Led Zeppelin was saying in the Stairway to Heaven? Now, the next time you come at me, and you tell me, it'll take me forever to read this. Don't wonder why I go off on you. You know why I go off on you. Human ease is what got you here to this point in time in the first place. If you require a handler and you require another father to protect you, don't even listen to my shows. You know, the majority of the lemmings that went off the cliff following the Piper were pushed off by the other lemmings. If you want to be a lemming, go elsewhere. If you have the willingness to learn, if you have the willingness to spend time educating yourself, and ensuring that you cannot be preyed on. You are being hunted. There is no other word for what Congress has been doing. You are prey. You are being hunted by a predator. A group of predators. A confederacy in action. Obama is clergy for Congress. Netanyahu is clergy for Congress. Stalin was clergy for Congress. Hitler was clergy for Congress. There is a predator hunting you. And if you don't want to spend the time learning, just stay away from us. It's as if the lemmings are coming at us and attempting to push us over the edge of the cliff. I won't tolerate that. You're just as bad as the predator. But if you have the willingness to learn and you have the willingness to stand up, it's not like you have to stand up and gun anybody down. You have to just stand up and stop patronizing it. I'm not asking you to put yourself on the front lines in some war theater somewhere. I'm asking you to patronize yourself, God. The word Jesus, Greek and Latin, it means your earth. You are Jesus. Your other names are Job and Judas and Eve and Delilah and Samson. These are all relatives' accounts of your walk. Shakespeare said that. All the world is a stage. You can take up whatever title you're going to take up. But ultimately, the only one that allows you to be standing again is Jesus. You're guaranteed that you can stand again. As to the physics, it's not some dream world you live in when you're acting as a relative state. And that's what Jesus was trying to say. Know thyself. Be relative. You are not a fiction. You are not a cartoon. You're not a concept. You are a state of being. Being. It's your only requirement. Be. Part of being is that you are obligated to protect the children. And then the follow through on that. God protects his children. Be God. Stop worshiping these demigods. Congress has become the Lord God. That's what it is. It's the Lord God Satan. You're worshiping a demigod. If you go into court and you ask a judge to protect you, you're worshiping a demigod. Call no man your father, not even Christ. Not even Jesus. What does that mean? It means patronize yourself. You are God. Stop buying into masculism and sexism and racism and feminism. You are God. Stop buying your benefits and rights from a demigod. That is so silly. It's ridiculous. It has taught you to feel sacrilegious when you worship yourself. What the heck? I need to define yourself. Yourself is not the ego. It is not the superego. It is not the id. It is the one you see outside of your eyes. You were taught and indoctrinated to see inward, imagination. That's not reality. That's not relativity. God, the being, protects the one in front of it. In the writing of those texts, there was no such thing as gender. Gender stems from the word genus. It means a new species. If you buy into feminism, you're giving up your authority, God, and buying the right to be a stock in a corporation. If you buy into masculism, God, you are purchasing your right to be a stock in a corporation, and you're giving up your inheritance. This is your kingdom. It's been shut up by Congress. Congress with transgression. The transgressor. It threw stuff in your path and then told you that you couldn't move that stuff. You have to stop living in that realm. It's a fictional realm. Those are fictions. Psychological experiment. If I poke on it this way, what's it gonna do? Go read Mises Institute. You can find out what you do when they poke on you that way. Go to the Cato Institute to find out how a civil war is being promoted by attorneys between law enforcement and citizens. That's war. It's war when Congress comes in and says, well, we don't like gay rights. No, wait a second. We like gay rights. Wait a second. Why are you separating my people? Those are actions of civil war. Feminism is an action of civil war. Masculism is an action of civil war. Why is Congress promoting and maintaining civil war? Why are you buying into this? It's absolutely profound to witness these things. Stop buying into it. Russia, Putin is a clergy for Congress. Australia Prime Minister, clergy for Congress. And as they point fingers at each other, Australia says it's Russia that brought down the Malaysian flight in the Ukraine. Everybody else says, no, it's not Russia, it's this or that. No, wait a second. Every one of those corporations, including Australia, are located in the District of Columbia. It was reported yesterday that the beings that were on that flight were already dead before that plane went down. And that was reported on the Associated Press. Those on the scene said that those bodies were already in states, in various states of decomposition. And now today they're reporting, oh, it's been 3 days and the bodies haven't moved. Of course not. They have to allow for the appearance of these things to hide the origins. And that's exactly what Vaclav Havel said. Identical. You know, we talk about this drug use. They're putting lithium in the water. These psychiatrists are coming in and saying, well, we're testing it now. We're testing levels now to determine how good we are at preventing suicide. Well, apparently it's not working because all of your officers and agents are killing men and calling it suicide, 35,000 of them a year. Not to mention that you're drugging everybody up with an action of soma theory in order to maintain them as pliable product. And of course, that was said by Aldous Huxley, called the Ultimate Revolution. You can find it on archive.org, the entire speech. Quote, and it seems to me perfectly in the cards that there will be within the next generation or so a pharmacological method of making people love their servitude and producing a kind of painless concentration camp for entire societies, so that people will in fact have their liberties taken away from them but will rather enjoy it, because they will be distracted from any desire to rebel by propaganda, brainwashing, or brainwashing enhanced by pharmacological methods. You're watching television programming and diagnosing yourself and rushing out to your medical doctor, your psychiatrist, to ask for those drugs. When you're on chronic pain medications without looking for the source of the pain, you're putting yourself within what is known as soma theory. Those prescription medications are writing you before you are. Prescribe. Prescriptions are engineering measures of diagnosis at a later point. The main effect of sleep medications, pain medications, is that it impedes the ability of your body to metabolize sugar. So it's not dimming pain, you're actually entering into a carb coma. This means that you will be, not could be, will be diagnosed with such as diabetes later. That's part of the farming. I know these things are painful. You know, in 3 years between 2000 and 2003, they are 37 of my family members. One car accident, surprise deaths. Aunt Isla went into the hospital, thought she had pneumonia, went down to the x-ray. She died on the x-ray table. They just killed her right there in Sunnyside Hospital. My husband was taken out after I went up against the Catholic diocese because I happened to be working there and I witnessed the sexual abuse of children. The drugging and sexual abuse of children. And rather than indicting them, I went to them and I told them on them. That'll show you. Well, immediately, within that next year, they killed my husband. And within the next 3 years, they wiped out 37 members of my family. The function of fourth generation warfare is to keep us on our knees. And it sure worked. It sure worked. They took my other half. They took everything. And by the time I came out of that in 2003, in May, they killed my grandmother, the only being I had left. And I was done. I was young and you know, I was gonna retire. You know, and I wasn't allowed to by my teachers. They kept a very watchful eye on me and made sure that I didn't give up. And at that point in time, I had no idea why they were busting my ass as they were. And I know now, as I sit here speaking to you, why they did that. We used to call Jeff Asshole Jesus because he was such a jerk. I mean, he was so hard on me. I know exactly why they did what they did. Because they love me. Because I love you beyond all measure. And I wouldn't be here if I didn't love you. I want to see you well. Otherwise, I could just walk away. our obligation is not to ourselves, it's to each other. And so often I have some people coming on to the YouTubes and to TammyPepperman.org, emails, Skype. I love you, Tammy. I love you, Tammy. I love you, Tammy. You have no idea. Because I know that you are God and I worship you. I have no other father. And I'm here until you hear me. You have no idea how much you are loved. I will continue to give my life for you until you hear me. And it's not because I promised a reward. I don't want anything. I don't want anything. Never have. There's a good article today at wakeupworld.com, The United Seeds of Apathy, and that's a good one to read. Going through my Facebook news feed, but we run out of time here. Advertisements, of course. Stop patronizing these sports teams. You know, it's been a little while since I deleted friends off my Facebook, but I'm tired of seeing football and baseball and all of these sports. If you're patronizing these things, and it's worse than patronizing Congress. It's worse than patronizing a psychiatrist or a doctor. You're patronizing a sport while you're maintaining the perpetual Olympics, judging each other, casting lots, and ensuring that you are crucifying each other. Is there a web link for studio and these books and documents, please? TammyPepperman.org. Everything's there in links, files, videos. We do a lot of videos. You can also find them at Bono's Entertainment. Bo is my producer, and that's on YouTube. My YouTube channel, Tamara K32, or Tammy K32, I think that one is. And I'm on Twitter, Tamara K7. I'm on Skype. Skype is the easiest way to get files from me, because it's a really cool venue. I can send very large files in a very short amount of time, and get with me on Skype. My Skype handle, of course, for the franchise name is T. Pepperman, and that's another thing I want to explain. The marketability of Tammy Pepperman is maintained by the executor on the estate, which is not me, it's my producer. And, we talk a lot about the last name and the descriptions and everything else, but in my past life, before I was reborn and we took over the franchise by a hostile takeover, establishing the United States court, everything, the name was known as Tammy Pepperman. You can go all the way back throughout the majority of my walk. I think I still have blogs way back in 2003, and just Google that name and you'll find all of my research. I have several blogs, not just TammyPepperman.org. There's another one on WordPress, Tammy Pepperman. I've also got one at Google group, Fathers Strife. That's Fathers apostrophe S, of course, STRIFE. And I put a lot of my documentation in there, conversations, my entire walk is always out there in various formats. We're trying to get everything into one location on TammyPepperman.org, and that is thanks to Tamworth Web Development. .co.uk. And again, if you'd like to donate, it's very much appreciated because it keeps us on the air. We do have the necessity of, space. These files, these videos, these documentations, everything, and you keep us going, as well as right here on Revolution Radio. If you want to donate, to keep us on the air, please do so. You can always look in the chat room to see how close we are to our goal. If you go to Revolution Radio at freedomslips.com chat and look over on the left, and it'll say what has been donated so far for the month and what we have left, covering the spread there. You can also visit the store. There's a store. You can listen to us on your mobiles. You can find the links on TammyPepperman.org as well as at freedomslips.com. There's just so much. And you know, again, it's not just us. You know, the person who sent me the message from chat is, of course, one of the producers at Revolution Radio, Justin. And we've got Kat and behind the scenes, a mad painter. We've got Hawk himself, Sally, everybody. Just, we're all in this together. And again, we are not federally funded, number one. Number two, we're not 501c3. Number three, because of that, we can only bring you the truth. We don't have another agenda. And that's the most important. You know, I'm watching these media plays today, and since the Malaysian airliner was shot down by Congress, and it's just amazing to see the propaganda that's being used and the finger pointing and all of these things. It's no wonder, you know, humanity is so confused. You've got so many things going on, and the Telegraph is saying one thing, and the RT is saying another, and CNN is saying, you know, the opposite of the other. But bottom line, if you go right now to the Broadcasting Board of Governors, or bbg.gov, go to their about page, and it says it all in about one sentence. It says the Broadcasting Board of Governors has full international control of all civil media. There's not one of them that's not in, you know, in line with the Confederacy. And we've seen some truth, you know, this year come out of CNN, and we saw some truth come out of RT, but it's only on a need-to-know basis. If they can control it, if they can control the flood or the potential damage, and they're not going to hemorrhage, they're going to expose you to a slight amount of the truth, but then all of a sudden it's going to be shifted elsewhere, and your attention is going to be shifted elsewhere. And, you know, the requirement is that you stay on your path, the walk of truth. Don't get sidelined, because that's what they require. That's what they count on. If you go all the way back to the Gelnhausen Charter, when it was called the House of Gelln, you'll find that they pretty much say it in the first paragraph. We're going to tell them anything we want to. They're going to forget about it anyway, because that's the socially engineered state. And realize that that was written back in 1180. How bad is it now? Well, we've seen how bad it was. I mean, I walked through, you know, a good 23 years before my husband was murdered by these folks with my head in my rectum. I was walking around, everything was sunshine, everything was flowers, I was an optimist, you know, a lot of crap had already happened, but I was always optimistic until I was exposed to the absolute truth, and then you realize how horrifying Congress is, how horrifying the medical industry is, psychological industry, the criminal industry, it's just horrifying. However, sorry, I'm just so sad or to go off on a rant, it seems hopeless. humanity is 97% of the global populace. In all of my research, in all of the psychological and sociological research, only 3% of the global populace are psychopaths. It's not huge. It's not something that you cannot overcome. Overcoming these things is stopping patriotism. That's basically your only obligation. Stop patronizing it. And when you stop patronizing it, that prompts you into being the father. You know, the most beautiful thing in Florida this week, a man walked in and somebody was sexually abusing his son, so he beat the hell out of him. And he called the law and he says, okay, come and pick up your thing. He's laying here in a puddle on the floor. Come and pick it up. That is the public law. That is leaving the farm. In action. Something, a psychopath was raping his child. He took care of it, and then he called out the garbage man. That's what is supposed to be occurring. Now, what would have happened if he would have just called 911 and said, oh, I need a restraining order, we gotta do these things. Somebody else cashes in, and that guy never learns a lesson. By the time that guy that was raping his child got into the law enforcement, he had admitted guilt. And he said, yes, I did it. And it was over. That child's not being rented. And that's my beef. You can't just charge a pedophile rent on a child. Pedophile needs to be held accountable. And it's our obligation to protect the children. It was never our design to rely on a fictional conglomeration of criminal enterprise that would offer us what appeared to be a remedy or some form of gimmick. That is not relative, and we have been so sorely swayed from any facet of relativity. Well, that's all Jesus said. Know thyself. Speak the word of God. What's the word of God? The truth. What's God? Life, the truth, reality, relativity. The whole work from the original manifest, the Old Testament, to the New Testament, the way to get off the ship. It's written in metaphor for a reason. Meta means self. For, P-H-O-R means knowledge of. So you're giving knowledge. You're given knowledge of yourself. This is your relative law. And again, you can take up whatever title you want to. You can be Job in there. Job didn't fare so well. You can be Samson. You can marry Delilah. Samson didn't fare very well. We'll be back again on next Wednesday, folks. Be well, everybody.